Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this introduction and overview of the Red Pitaya from RS Components. So big thanks to RS Components, they put this in my hands. Now of course the big first question is, what is the Red Pitaya? And basically it's a software development platform. When I say software, it's a combination of a hardware and software development platform and a bench measurement tool. And a tool which can be configured in limitless ways. So off the bat, this runs off Linux. It has an oscilloscope, a spectrum analyzer, and a function generator. However, there's already a developers forum, what they call their bazaar, and you can already find applications for LCR meters. I've heard of software-defined radios. So the options are potentially limitless with this little device. It can be remotely operated. You can insert a wireless USB dongle into here, so you could be taking measurements or injecting signals into a test circuit halfway across the world. The oscilloscope and function generator are limited to 50 megahertz, but I think for many applications that won't be a limitation. It is a limitation, but I think the functionality of the open source software and being able to program this to do what you want is a very powerful tool. Now I mentioned LCR meter, and before I talk about LCR meter, let me mention this costs $470. So off the bat, someone might think that's fairly expensive, and of course for a tool for your bench, if you're not into research, and let's say you're starting off, that may seem expensive. But if you had to acquire those basic tools, an oscilloscope, a spectrum analyzer, and a function generator, you're going to probably pay upwards of $1,000. You will of course have dedicated devices, perhaps with knobs and buttons, as opposed to something you need to interface with, let's say your computer, smartphone, or tablet. But you then have functionality beyond that, because this can be programmed to do other things. And in the one thing that caught my eye was this LCR meter. And the reason was is that you can get a frequency response across the device under test. So if you're testing, let's say, a capacitor, you can do a frequency response and see how that capacitor is going to respond over a whole frequency range and have that plotted out. And I know that specialized test equipment to do that will cost you from $5,000 to $7,000. So that's one of the things I'm looking forward to playing with fairly soon with this. But anyway, let's get onto the bench so we can take a closer look. So here is the device. And let me say up front that when I first received this and I heard I was going to get it, I was a little bit intimidated because I don't really have a lot of time to play around with a development platform. And I was concerned this would take a fair bit of time to kind of get set up and get started. And at the end of the day, the setup and getting started with this can happen very quickly. I did, however, get caught out by one little gotcha. This boots off a Linux OS, which is on a micro SD card. And the micro SD card that I had was a class 2, so a slower card. And when I powered this up and I was looking for it on the network, I couldn't see it. And it took me a fair bit of troubleshooting. I connected a USB cable. It's got inputs here for console, so you can see the Linux boot up, or you can walk around the OS or the storage on here through a Linux interface. And I discovered that it wasn't loading the SD card correctly, and thus it wasn't initiating the kind of LAN interface and what have you. And that's where I found out the speed of the card was the issue. I notified the support folks at Red Pitaya, and literally within a day they had updated the help files, which is a wiki help file and documentation on this. But once, if you have that all sorted out, you can get up and running very quickly. At the heart of this device, there's an FPGA which is mounted under this heatsink. It's got, as I recall, about 512K of RAM. The key connectors on this are, you've got two inputs, which are your two channels for your oscilloscope. And it's always scary to start defining the functions, because you can obviously program this to do a number of things. But basically, these are the two inputs for the oscilloscope. These would be the two outputs for your function generator. These inputs would also work for the spectrum analyzer as well. It's got some jumpers on the board, which are labeled HV and LV. These are for either high voltage or low voltage inputs for these two analog inputs. So you've either got a 1 volt full scale or 20 volt full scale range by changing these jumpers. The connectors, these connectors extend the digital I/O on here, or the analog I/O.
on the board. So you've got access to the pinouts from the FPGA or some analog input and output. These eSATA type connectors are used for daisy chaining. As far as I know, you can daisy chain these Red Piata units together. You've got your USB connection over here, which, as I said, could be used for using a wireless dongle, so you can access this wirelessly, or you've got a hardwired LAN connection. On the side, we've got some LEDs. The first couple, you've got a blue one. We'll see this when we've got it powered up. That denotes that the FPGA is ready and okay. Then you've got one that tells you your power is okay, and then the rest are related to the FPGA status. On the underside, we've got two micro USB connections. The one is for power. They recommend you need a 2-amp 5-volt connection for the power. I'll put one of Frankie Tong's monitors on this when we fire it up so we can see what it actually draws. I think it just draws under an amp. But if there's a little peak draw, you certainly want something which is capable of delivering more than an amp. And then you've got your micro USB so you can connect to this, to the console. So literally, it is a little mini computer running Linux, so you can connect to it and obviously walk around the Linux system. On the underside, it's got the supporting componentry on it. So it's a fairly densely packed little board. So getting started is fairly straightforward. Once you've got your micro SD card with your Linux boot inside the SD card slot, you then can connect your LAN connection, and then you're ready to connect your power connection, which is the first micro USB connector over here. Now, as I power it up, we'll be able to see the current, which is drawing about 700, 800, 850 milliamp. We can see the blue light flashing, or is now steady, so there's a green power light, and the FPGA is saying that it's ready, and then there's one of the FPGA lights is blinking, so that's in its correct state. By default, this will do a DHCP call to get a DHCP IP address, but you can configure, you can go into the files before this boots up on your PC, you can configure one of the network files to configure it for a static IP address. But once it comes up, you're ready to load your browser and go to the web interface of the device. I've gone and set up the IP address, which just happens to be 131 for my network address. And then you enter that, and then you get the web application. And straight away, you can see it says get more applications. That will take you to the bazaar, where you can, what they call their bazaar, which is their application market or repository. And that's where you can go install other applications that other folks have developed. By default, you've got your spectrum analyzer, your oscilloscope, and your generator and oscilloscope. So the generator and oscilloscope allows you to run both those applications. So if you want to kind of feed the generator signal straight out of the output and into the input of the scope, you can do that as well. So what I'm going to do now, we'll start off by firing up the oscilloscope, and I'll have a signal coming in so we can see how well that works. So I'll run the oscilloscope application. That fires up, and by default, it's got both channel 1 and channel 2 enabled, so I'll switch off channel 2, and now I'll switch on my function generator. And there's the incoming signal. I'll just change the mode so we can trigger on it. And there we go. We've got the signal on there. So I was very surprised with the performance. I expected, just like if you've got a cheaper oscilloscope looking at a signal, the display can be a bit bouncy and the update cannot be that great. And I was very surprised. I'll just make some adjustments. So as I make adjustments to the frequency of that input signal, you can see it's happening very quickly on the display. I was really surprised at how well that works at the update on the display. To me, it almost has like an analog feel of an analog scope. The line on the side here is the trigger, so you can move the trigger to different points. So at the top there, it's not triggering, and now we get getting down to the triggered signal. On this little computer that I've got here, the display is obviously very small. So what I'm going to do next, I'm going to kick the function generator into action, and the output we'll have on the Tektronix oscilloscope, but we'll do it from my desktop PC. So I have the Red Piata sitting on my bench top over there. I've just left it still connected to the other computer. And then I've got the Tektronix oscilloscope ready to receive a signal from it. Now, if I come back to my desktop, so I've got the web browser open to the Red Piata,
And what I'm going to do first off is actually just see the oscilloscope on the screen here, because I've obviously got a bigger display here, so it's easier to see things and operate it. You could easily be doing this on a tablet or a cell phone as well, which will run the oscilloscope. And here we go, straight away, I've got the both signals, so I'll just switch off the one channel. We've got the trigger, which can move around, and that is the signal coming through. You can obviously go and change your, you can see your measurements. You can go and change your range, so your X and your Y axis, so your time base. It's very, I must say, very responsive. I'm going to say, this is something I pick up with using oscilloscopes. Once you've used an analog oscilloscope, you really see the benefit of the quick updates on the screen, because it is analog and not digital. And this response, even though it's going through a network and a small little device, really has surprised me. So the operation and scaling happens very quickly. Scaling the voltage scale and coming back. You can obviously change your trigger sources, your mode, your edge, whether it's rising, and the level. This is a very simple oscilloscope, but certainly for anyone who's just doing something basic or getting started, I imagine it's more than enough. And of course, Bitsong could go and write another application which improves on this oscilloscope application. But next, let's go back and see how the function generator operates. So I click on the run. So this now brings in two applications. So again, what I'm going to kick out is channel one. At the moment, the signal isn't triggered. That we're not worried about. We, down here, we can see it says signal generator. So I click on that. And you'll notice it's got two outputs for the signal generator. So I've got the Tektronix scope connected to channel one. At the moment, that's not ticked. So here we go, it's got a sine wave. I'm going to say we'll put a signal in of 1 volt peak to peak, frequency of 1,000 hertz, and I'm not too sure how I've got the Tektronix set up, so we'll see if it comes through. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to click on this to enable it and then show you the output. So I'll take you to the Tektronix oscilloscope, and what I'm going to do now is just click that channel one. And there we go, I've got the signal coming out remotely at my desk. And just, I'm obviously sitting here in my lab. I don't necessarily need the remote function from my desktop, but still in some cases, I might be want to sit at my desktop and do remote measurement or inject a signal into a circuit. And as I said, this could be, you could have a research lab down a hallway and you could be sitting in an office doing this, or you could be sitting halfway around the world. And that's the power of a device like this. What I'm going to do, just for fun, I'm just going to make a few changes to the parameters here and see how that comes out on the Tektronix scope. So I'm just going to change that to a square wave. And there, it's not, the square wave is not triggering. Just try triangle. And we've got the triangle. And then it's also got, I'll just quickly change the frequency, whether 1,000 hertz or 1 kilohertz, I'll change it to 2. And there we go, you can see that change. But it also has the option of uploading your own signal. So that's something I haven't played around with yet. But if I pull this down, you can see it says upload from file. I know you can insert a CSV file with the signal information and then customize or upload a custom signal. So again, loads of possibilities. On the Red Piatto website, you've got this Bazaar, which is their application marketplace. And these are the three applications that you get by default once you first fire it up. But if we go down, you can see these other applications have already been developed. So there's something called CalScope. So it's oscilloscope upgraded with DC offset calibration trace. So there's another oscilloscope. We've got a CalGenScope. Calibrate two-channel waveform generator with integrated two-channel time zone signal visualization system. You've got the LCR meter. Now, LCR meter, say, this is something I'm really keen to try to see how well that works. And loading these applications is fairly straightforward. What we're going to do, we'll go back to the web interface. And if I go back to the main home screen, you've got a button here called Get More Applications. So I haven't used this. I'm keen to install the LCR side. So it brings us to this screen. And we've got the install options, and I'm going to go and install this LCR meter.
And literally, by the looks of things, it looks like it's installed. So let's go to the home screen of my device. And lo and behold, it's all that, it was literally that click. Click on it, and it downloaded the application that quickly. Now, for fun, I'll push run, but I know I have to make some hardware configuration changes to get this to work. So this will be one of the applications I play with in the near future. You do need to attach a shunt resistor, and then you've got your device under test. So they've got this diagram in a help file which shows you how it's all set up. And then you can go and do measurement sweeps or frequency sweeps to go and see the response of whatever you've got under the test, whether it's an inductor or a capacitor or something like that. So that we'll be playing with. So the other question that springs to mind is an enclosure for the Red Piata, because you may have an application, you want better protection for it. I mean, you may be the kind of person that goes out on the job and you need a little multi-tool like this to do troubleshooting. And if you go and search, there are loads of enclosures. And I think one enclosure you can buy from RS Components. You can also go and download plans and 3D print your own enclosure. Now, this is something I actually plan to do with the Maker Gear guys. So I've mentioned them before. Maker Gear are the guys that actually have come to some of our meetups, and they've shown interest in producing their own enclosure for it. So they're going to get hold of one of these Red Piatas, and I'm going to go out to them, and they'll show me the design process of actually designing an enclosure and then printing it on one of their printers.
So there we go. That's a quick overview of this device. It's going to take a long time for me to do a few really full thorough review on it, because there is so much functionality involved. I'm going to start off by doing a video which does a getting started and connected, but just to get through the potential gotchas, just to help someone who wants to get started using it. Who is this device aimed at? Now, I say it's a fairly unique device. I'd call it a little Swiss knife of kind of bench test and measurement. It's got the kind of functionality, in fact, that the Tektronix MDO Scope has. Of course, it's not going to replace the Tektronix MDO Scope. The Tektronix MDO Scope is a dedicated high-end device. But for someone who would like to start playing around with a spectrum analyzer, an oscilloscope, function generator, and then have add-on applications, I think the world is your oyster. I'm sure there are lots of folks in research and development who would find this very useful. What about the beginner? Because that kind of crossed my mind. I think if you're a total novice beginner and you, let's say, want to start learning how to use an oscilloscope, this might be a little bit intimidating, because you've got to have, let's say, another device like a computer or a tablet, and you're clicking on the screen to make adjustments to use that functionality. It might not, and of course, it doesn't have all the functionality of even an entry-level oscilloscope. However, your mileage may differ. You may not want a dedicated device with knobs and buttons, and this might be right up your alley. You're quite happy to have a basic oscilloscope like that with the added functionality of a function generator and a spectrum analyzer off the bat. But anyway, very soon I'm going to start playing around with the applications, and I say the first one I want to demonstrate is that LCR meter, because that really fascinates me. But anyway, I'll post links down below, so there's more information on Wiki and on RS Components and the Allied website. And if you can think of any interesting applications, or whether this is a tool that you'll find useful at all, then certainly post your comments below. Thanks very much for watching. I'll catch you soon for the next video. Cheers.